Thank you for participating in this interview as a small contribution to International Women's Day 2014. The aim of this project is to give the opportunity to communicate with inspirational female leaders within the UN, such as yourself.
We hope these interviews can be a tool to empower young women like us, who will be inspired and motivated to achieve successes by the example of yourself as a role model. This supports the theme for this year's International Women's Day, Equality for Women Means Progress for All. We are excited by the opportunity to talk with leading women at the very top of the UN system in order to gain insight into how they achieve their positions of leadership and learn about their experiences and challenges in doing so. My name is Daisy Dunford and I am 10 years old. I study at Blackheath High Junior School.
My name is Elara Surety and I'm 17 years old and I study at Blackheath High School Seniors Department.
My name is Trisha Nadimi and I'm 11 years old. I study at Blackheath High Junior School.
So ladies, it's really great to have the chance to meet you and to have the opportunity of this exchange. It's a real honor for me to be one of the people who you are interviewing for your project.
It's an honour for us to be interviewing you.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So, do you want to go about this with questions, or how do we manage it?
We've got some questions we'd like to ask you, so shall we begin?
Please, yes. Go ahead.
So, what is a typical working day in the life of Susana Malcorra, and what is your favourite part of your job?
Well, I'm afraid I don't have pretty much a typical working day. You know, in the job I have as the chef de cabinet to the Secretary General, our working day is based on essentially how the world is that day. And I'm sure you are aware the world changes dramatically overnight. So it's hard to have a typical working day, but I do enjoy a lot our morning meeting with the Secretary General. That's how we start our journey during every day's work. Trying to take a view of what are the priorities for that day and where the world stands that day and how we should adjust to that. What I really enjoy a lot also is how we change as the day goes. And I think that's one of the things I have learned with time is that it's very hard to have a fixed established plan for your day, but you need to really grab and go for it as it comes, adapt and really get the best of out of you in this those changes that come your way, and in the meantime trying to manage what was supposed to be your normal day in your diary as the day started. So I think the thing I love the most is the change and the energy that comes out of improvising, because the day brings you something new as the day comes along.
Thank you.
It definitely sounds like quite a fun working day one away, the way it sounds, with the energy. What's it like to be a woman working for the UN across countries that might have different cultural expectations of women and the place of women in that country?
Well, I find working in the UN a very, very, very interesting challenge. I haven't worked for the UN for that long. It's going to be 10 years later this year, so I'm not a long UN staff, and I still enjoy the pleasure of getting the sense of what the UN means, because my whole life has not been the UN, so I can enjoy the contrast and the comparison. And the exposure to different cultures, of course, is one of the big pluses of the UN. Sometimes through that exposure, you realize how challenging the world is for women in many parts of the of the different regions. Sometimes you, through the exchange you have and the exposure you have, you find yourself with the opportunity to make a case just by dealing with the issues being a woman. I remember, you know, going to Afghanistan and just being a senior leader, going into the deep Afghanistan in itself, being a woman senior leader, represented a challenge in some places. And for me, it was just being there was the best opportunity to make the case for the women in Afghanistan. You didn't even have to talk about it. You just were there, you were meeting with the dealers, with the leaders, you were making your case by being part of the conversation. And of course, that, in my view, is stronger than many words, just you being there. Learning how women make an impact in different parts of the world and sometimes are not even taken into account is something that has come very strong to me. I always remember the first time I went to Africa, to a refugee camp, and we flew over, and as we flew and got closer to the refugee, we found a very, very long circle of deserted land. And then I learned that the land was deserted around that refugee camp because women go out every day to fetch for wood and water. And of course, the more they have lived in the refugee camp, the more they have to walk because the water and the wood is far. It's farther every time. And then I learned that in that journey that they have to take every day is where they are assaulted and they are really exposed to the most horrendous attacks. So just by visiting them and seeing from the air what the land looked like, it was clear to me the suffering and the incredible challenges that women have in some of the roughest parts of the world. And it was very, very motivating for me to come back and then make the case for those refugees. So that's what it means to be in the UN, just to be exposed and to be able to advocate for those issues in a way that you cannot do unless you yourself have seen it and have touched it.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. What was life like when you were in high school and what was your dream job then?
Well, I had a great life in high school. I enjoy school. I'm an only child. So for my parents, I was all the hope for the future. So that meant, of course, that they were very, very much geared towards excellence. And I think that determined a lot who I am and what I am. My father in particular felt that his only daughter, his only child, had no limit. So I think that prepared me mentally as a woman not to accept any limitations, you know. He always said, just go for it. Whatever you like, you do it, but you do it with excellence. So that was the theme for me. And of course, I was a hard student. I like what I did. And I was not clear to me, particularly at your younger age, what I was going to be, because I like almost everything, you know. I like reading math, reading physics, I like science, I like Spanish. But then when I was 14, I came to the United Nations for 1 year as part of exchange program, and I lived with an American family for 1 year, which was the most absolute experience, changing experience for me. First, because I discovered a totally different culture from mine, but second, because in school I specialized essentially in science and mathematics, and there I took the decision that engineering was going to be my future, and that's where I started. But again, life has proven that you never know where you're going to finish. And starting from engineering, here I am in the United Nations as the chair of the cabinet to the Secretary General. So one lesson is keep your mind open. Always be ready for changes and try to seize the opportunities as they come.
Thank you.
It's definitely some good advice.
Yes. Yeah. So as young women, we're taught to be resilient. Can you tell us of the times when you have had to be resilient? How do you deal with sad and upsetting events and overcome setbacks? What was the best advice you've ever received?
Well, probably one of the things that again, after that trip that I mentioned earlier, the second event that really was a dramatic one that had a huge impact in my life was when my father died. I was very young. I was 18 when he died. And it was an unexpected loss, totally unexpected loss. He was very young and he was in Brazil. I'm from Argentina, so he was traveling in Brazil. And for many reasons, which I will not go into now, I was the one who had to go to Brazil on my own to, I thought at that point that he was still ill, but then when I arrived, he had already died. So that was a very dramatic turning point in my life. I had only started engineering a few months before that, and I had an expectation from my parents that they would be looking after me, and of course I would go through university just dedicated myself to study, and all of a sudden my life changed. My father was the breadwinner of the family. My mother had never worked. And, you know, within a few weeks, I learned that I had to study, to start not only studying, but also to start working to support the family. And it was a very quick decision, the ones that you take even without thinking much about it. But it was a dramatic departure from anything that I had in mind so far. On top of that, losing your father, who, as you may notice, was a very significant figure for me. But I guess, again, what I didn't know at the time is that my parents had prepared me to take advantages of all opportunities. And opportunities come in all flavors. And some are very good, some are very dramatic, very difficult. And you just have to get the best out of them and to grow into yourself and do whatever is needed to get to the next step. And, you know, as I think backwards, probably this dramatic moment meant a real difference in what I am and how I'm the one that takes things on and just goes for it. So that's it. It's not good enough to have grievances, to feel bad. You know, you have to go through all of that. You have to feel the loss of whatever happened. But then you have to think about life as, you know, the future that is there for you. And you just have to go for the future. And if you go with a strong will and conviction, you will get there.
Thank you. Thank you for that advice.
One of our learning pillars at Blackheath High School is enterprise. What advice would you give to girls at school and in other places on how to succeed in the world stage and help the global community?
Well, the first advice is that you need to prepare yourselves. You know, you are at a stage in your lives where time is well invested in education, in reading, in understanding the issues is very important. And be as broad, looking to as many things as you can. Read a lot. Reading is very, very important. Get a sense of cultures through reading, for example. Of course, today, compared to my young age, there are so many other options beyond reading. You know, you have multimedia, you have internet, but I still believe that going to the basics of reading a book of somebody who wrote from a certain culture gives you a flavor, gives you a nuance that you don't get anywhere else. So that's my first advice. Educate yourselves, prepare yourselves. One thing that to me is very important is languages. You know, do as much as you can on languages, because that opens again your mind to the broad world. That is where I will suggest you invest your time now. As per the rest, just don't plan too much. This is something that is against what most people will say. I think you need to trust your own instincts. So the better and the stronger you are prepared, I'm sure that your instincts work better. But essentially what you have to do is sail the waves of opportunity. So if you think that what you want to do is this or this, but all of a sudden something else comes up, something that you were not expecting, just don't disregard it. Just think about it. Think about, is this something that I should consider? Maybe this is something that I didn't think about because it's totally new and different, but maybe going for it will bring me to some uncharted waters. So be open, be flexible, be ready, but most importantly now, prepare yourselves well and invest as much as you can in your own education, because that's the thing that will never go away.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you for that.
Who inspired you when you were in school? Who inspires you now?
Can you repeat that? It didn't come clear.
Okay. Who inspired you when you were in school? Who inspires you now?
Well, I have a lot of inspirations. And again, going back to what I said earlier, my parents have been an inspiration. And I think that's a very important piece of my whole being, you know. The family aspect for me is very, very important. So, to me, having a very strong family and with strong values was the first inspiration. I had a couple of teachers that were very inspirational to me also, and at that time, it was very, very important. Of course, in the bigger scheme, I remember having JFK, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, as being a big inspirational leader when I was very young, and that was something that I felt was moved me very, very, very much. These days, I have a lot of inspirational leaders. Of course, the Secretary General is somebody whom I work very close with, and I have the privilege to work with, be with, and see very closely one of the leaders of the world. So that's very good and very, very personally inspiring to me. I get to see many leaders of the world, So many different inspirations come from them, but at this point in time, I'll just keep it there so I don't get into a political incorrect commitment on whom will be the preferred one, except to say that, of course, Nelson Mandela comes across as one of the most inspirational leaders we have had in the last decades.
Definitely.
Yes. So, in your opinion, how is gender equality an effective tool to drive progress for all?
Well, you know, it's the only option one can argue. When you think about, and this is in terms of economic development, and let's not talk about anything else for a minute. When you look at the world, and the world being integrated by 50% female and 50% male population, the notion that you only tap into the talent of 50% of the pool is just nonsense. So when you think about longer term development, there is no doubt that you need to empower women to become part of that large pool of talent that you source from in order to further the economic and social development of the world. When you think about in terms of sustainability also, women are the ones who most of the time, in most parts of the world, have the dual role of keeping the family together and being the drivers of the family, and then being contributors to the larger development issues. And that makes things much more sustainable because women are the ones that connect the two worlds, the family and the rest. So I think without any doubt, the fact that women become players that become fully empowered and become really relevant is not only a duty and a right for women, it's a duty and a right for the world. So this sort of a conflict or opposition between women's empowerment and the notion of whether this is right or not, it's just absolutely nonsense, because only the world will achieve the real sustainable long-term development when women are fully empowered and take part of it.
Very interesting. I think I completely agree with that. I think that's actually all we have time for right now. Thank you so much for your time and allowing us to interview you.
It's been an honor.
Thank you. And really, I wish you the best in your project. I hope we can contribute to your project, all the colleagues that are being interviewed, in a manner that gets you to a very, very good place, and you can celebrate UN Women in 2014 with added value coming from us. So thanks a lot for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.